Well done.
I'm going to try and do a typical session that I do over the years at Waterford. So I just, you know, in case you see it's very haphazard, how long would I normally go and things like that. It's very, very rushed. So you'll have simple things like the girls are just going to solo run around a minute, forwards, backwards, balancing the ball and the hurley, different things like that. And before we actually go into the specifics of the working together kind of group that we do. And again, I'll come back on TE where I say, Jesus, I do this with the six-year-old group. It might be helpful for ye. Because, you know, I'm here to learn myself as much as yourselves. If you just come around here, girls, and if you just start solo running around randomly, I'll call it forwards, backwards, right, left, and all that kind of stuff. So off you go, forwards, backwards, right, left, forwards, backwards. Okay, listen up this time. Every time you hear the whistle, I just want them to do that. Okay, again, if you have the six-year-old group like me, and this week we had the egg and spoon race in St. Eklund's in De La Salle. My young fellow's running junior infants. So you're teaching them to cheat at five, right? You're not teaching them to cheat, but you're teaching them basically the coordination skills around the egg and spoon is very similar to the solo run. So you have the thumb down the hurley like this, but you're teaching them to hold the hurley, the ball here, by the black tape with his left hand. So if you have the group of 5 and 6 year olds like me, and you're saying, oh, solo run is too in advance for my group, they're dribbling around, that's fine. But you can also get them to just hold the hurley in one hand, hold the ball in the other hand, and they're running around with the ball in their hand. Simple enough. Then they're doing this. They can do this with one hand on the hurley like this. Then they can go to this with the thumb on the hurley. Then they can leave the thumb go. And you'll be surprised how much the coordination skills, the eye, everything improves. So when I say to the girls they're doing this, when they whistle, they say, oh, that's really simple. I'm foreseeing that when this girl is solo running here, what's your name? Ashley. When Ashley is solo running, right, you just, when I blow the whistle, put it up off the hurley, right? That she's read my intention to flick the ball off the hurley. So even though you think that's very simple, right? And an advanced one of that, I'll show you a second. So every time you hear the whistle, girls, just do that. Look, very simple, okay? We've about 3 minutes on this. And solo run as well, girls, at the same time, yeah? Okay, now, an advanced one. If you're in the development squad under 17 Cork team or Tip team, or you've this unbelievable Camogie team on your hands, sometimes a better one there is to actually encourage them to flick it out to the side. Because the likelihood is, I'm right half forward here, I'm going in on goal, and the girl is coming across me with a flick, that I'll probably have to flick it out to myself and then regain control before I score. So a simple one here is, look, when you hear the whistle, flick it out to themselves, then regain control. So have a go at this, forwards, backwards, right, left, on the whistle, flick it out to yourself. Good, so let's try and, if you want to teach them how to flick it out to themselves, right, it's just flick it out to the side. So it's this, look, and try and get it before, so it's that, look, and then that. So again, you're at home with your young lad of 5 or 6, and you're saying to him, hold it with the thumb down the hurley, and it's that, look. So it's that. So you're getting them used to doing that with no ball, and you'd be surprised how effective it is. Okay, come in here, girl. Come in here. Do 15 roll lifts for me for a start. 15 roll lifts. Off you go, as quick as you can. Now, in terms of, you're obviously going to teach that roll lift, right, to a class, to a young group. You're going to teach the jab lift. What we're going to encourage here now is, sorry, they're looking to see me on the camera now, don't get me wrong. It's not any self-indulgence on my behalf, I can assure you that. So what we're looking for here is, when you're picking, not to put their hand to it straight away, because two or three girls come here, right? You watch today, I'm going to watch Waterford and Tip in the Camogie, or Waterford and Dublin in the Camogie today, 4 o'clock. So there'll be a situation where three of us will be over the ball here, right? And there'll be a situation sometimes where I might have to pick it, not straight away. So we're developing 1.5 seconds. Now, if you're the coach at home and you're a club team, you're saying we want to get the ball in our hands straight away, that's fine. I'm only talking about a situation where tonight there might be a situation where two or three girls are over the ball and someone's hand will just come in and snap the ball away. Willie O'Connor was a master of Wilkenny, a cornerback, brilliant at it. The hand would just come in the last minute and he'd snap it. How do you teach that? You teach it by asking the girls not to put their hand to it straight away, boom, and then you get them to move afterwards. Similarly, I'm left corner back here, right? I'm playing this way, and I have a bit of pace, and there's grass in front of me. So everything that I don't have, I'm pretending to have now, all right? Everything I don't have. So what you're going to encourage is, obviously if you have time, you're going to jab lift it normally, like you would do with any group. But sometimes you might have to throw it up in front of you and get on it. Okay, so in a group before training, you can just get used to throwing it up in front of them, catching, right, rather than picking it straight away. Because, again, look in your head, I'm left corner back, the space out there, I'm throwing it out in front of me, and I'm getting onto it. I might even throw it out in front of me before I pick it. So it just, I suppose it simulates a match experience. You know, these things happen in matches. Those type of picks happen in matches. All right? So the next one is the third catch. I'm on the third catch. I'm right corner forward here. I'm going in on goal. I'm on the third catch. And I catch it the third time. Everyone's giving out to me. Three catches, blah, blah, blah. So the ability to be able to just drop it down to yourself and play it to yourself and have a bit of composure. Okay? Again, you're the six-year-old coach. How do you do that? You're saying, Christ, I can't do that with a 5 and 6 year old. You're like that. All you do is this, look, drop it down to yourself, pick it, develop that. Develop that with the 5 and 6 year old. If you want to go to full hog, put down two cones and just get them used to just doing that. Nice and low. Look, just even if they just clap hands. I know that sounds very basic, but it's very good because then it'll develop this, look. Look, just get them to used to doing that. All right, then it'll develop that, okay? So, again, look, I'm on my third catch. Just play it down to myself. Okay, so let's have a go at this, guys, right? That when I blow the whistle, just put playing it down to yourself, okay? Off the third catch. These are just activation stuff. Have a go at it. Lovely. Ah, look at that. Good stuff. Off the hurley now, girls. Instead of saying this, oh, geez, I'm dummy hand passing. Again, I'm left corner back. Look. And I'm going along solo running. And I dummy hand passing. I go this way. Again, if you're in a group with 6 to 8, 10 year olds, get them to just do this, look. Just that. And then they'll have the ball in their hand and they'll be after just getting used to kind of drawing somebody in. Drawing somebody in. So this young man, come out here for a second. You're like myself, split personality. This man is going to tackle me, right? He's Cork and Limerick man tackling me at once, right? So he tackles me, but he comes across me like this. But every now and again, if I just do that, he might come in here like that. And then I can get away at a pass. So just by dummying. So what I'm asking the girls to do, we often do in training is, look, dummy hand pass on the whistle. Dummy hand pass on the whistle. Dummy hand pass. Okay? Then just pick it yourself. Look, pick. Then just play it yourself. So all these things hand passing to each other. That you're not doing the same thing all the time. You've integrated the skills at the start of the session and the thing will flow after that. So let's have a go, girls, at look, simple dummy hand pass. What's the biggest thing that happens there? They throw it up and catch it. They throw it up and catch it. So again, if you've the youngest group, if you're the youngest, get them to pass it to each other's hands. Better get past it to each other's hands. That's it, ah, that's it, run them down here. Okay, good stuff. Now what we'd often do is here, so what we'd often do then in training is a simple thing, like just to build a bit of, you stand opposite the same girl and you're just hand passing the same to each other, the same two balls going at the same time. So we just hand pass the ball. Now what I often do then to change that up, because the girls can drop the hurley, we'd often do with the boys is just go from one hand to the other, and when the coach blows the whistle, we both hand pass at the same time. Just a bit of coordination skills. Then another one is this, we both stand opposite each other like this. I roll lift and hand pass into one go. We both roll lift and hand pass into one go. Now to build in what I talked about, the delay, sometimes roll lift, dummy hand pass, then hand pass. So roll lift even shows for a second. And these are all just things we do at the start of a session. Roll lift, delay, then hand pass. So it sounds, you say to yourself, Jesus, it's so simple. But you'd be surprised the amount of times that if you do that, and you do that, and then you go, you'll actually be after creating a bit of composure in your head, and you'll be after creating a bit of space for yourself by just doing that. And that all happens in about 7 minutes before the boys go down and do their activation, which is, you know, I always finish the session with those as well. At the very end of the session, we go back ball each, and obviously introduce striking into that part as well. Striking, little flicks with the one hand, dummy hand pass along the grass. So Quiva is right corner forward playing against me. I'm left corner back, she has me held up, and I'm just hand passing around the corner, along the grass. So around the corner. So when you're teaching that, that it's not just getting the lads to throw it to each other, that you're getting them to do this first. Look, no ball in their hand. Around the corner. So that action, look at that action, it's simple. That action. But the amount of times that I've seen, we'll say, a Carl Barrett is corner back at the moment with Tip, we'll say, and Brendan Marr outside him, that they come out and they're held up and they either have to go like that or they have to go like that. That or that. And people say, ah, that's stupid. You watch back now, do your YouTube homework tonight now. Go back on Dearman O'Keefe scoring the first half for Wexford last week, and you'll see Lee Moog McGovern is caught up and he gives a lovely hand pass like that. Right? Dearman O'Keefe gets it, it's over the bar. These things are not gimmicks. These things that are applicable here will happen as the child goes forward. The earlier you develop in that, with him. So you have the 6 year old in front of you. And if you get him, just do that, look, with no ball. You'll actually, if you get them to open their hand and do that, open their hand and do that. When I'm caught up by Gil Hahn here, right, and he has me up here like this, I'll just be able to get this done. I'll be able to get that done. And I'll be able to get it away without throwing it. Okay, so that's a typical start to a session. Just imagine my group here are 5 to 10 year olds, and I have 4 of them in there. I have a ball between one of the groups of 4, okay? And my brief is weak striking, tackling, and my brief with any session is ensuring that they're happy, they're enjoying the whole thing, and they're working together, right? They're working together. So, what we do normally is you'd have a girl at each of these stations, like in a diamond on the outside. The 4 girls in the middle are working together as one group. So normally you'd bib them up. You might have a red group bib, a red group green bib, or a blue bib, blah, 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 right? You have a group here. All they have to do as a group is, when I blow the whistle, this group of 4 girls set off to one of the girls here. They give the hand pass to her, they get the ball back off her. So you'd imagine, just give us that for a second, 3, 4 of you come at me, girls, for a second. You stay there. 4 of us walk, go over, we run over, we give the hand pass here, we get it back, we hand pass it to each other on the way over if we want it. On the way over then we see, oh Jesus, one of the other groups are going to this girl. We don't put our hands up in the air and say, oh Jesus, there's someone else going over there, look how we cope, you know what I mean? There's a randomness to this that builds a kind of a working together mentality to the whole thing. So basically the girls can decide that they are going to pass it to each other, or they can decide that we one or two passes and we'll go to another girl. They don't have to necessarily pass it to each other and say, Jesus, Kate never got a touch of the ball, Queevy never got a touch of the ball, how will she cope? It depends. Now, you've the 6-year-old group, right? The 6-year-olds all run over here. They hand it to this boy, to this, and they get it back. They hand it to each other on the way over. They run over here. They hand it to this girl. They get it back off them, right? What does it build? It builds the whole mentality of, look, say I'm wing forward here and I've hit the ball in here, right? Did you ever have someone in your group that just looks at the ball as after going in, you know? And geez, my work is done. You know, that's lovely. Ah, geez, that's smashing, like, you know? Smashing. And they're leaning back and they think they'll go back on the hurley and they'll say, this is nothing to do with me. Nothing to do with me. What this builds is a culture of, hey, we're all in this together. You know, we're all in this together. Now, how do you introduce the weak side? If you're going into the mentality of, you know, ready position, grip, and you're up here and you're introducing the weak side mentality, you've done all the necessary kind of technical parts of hitting off the weak side. Then what you can do is you can say to yourselves, well, one of the girls will hit it off their weak side to this girl. She'll get it. She'll introduce the weak side as part of this drill, so that you're hitting it as opposed to just hand passing to each other. But we're gonna have a run at it. So just girls, explain what's involved. When I blow the whistle, you'll run randomly to any one of the girls. You'll hand pass it to one of the girls on the end. She'll hand pass it back to you. You'll run as a 4 to one of the other girls, any of the 4 girls. You'll get it back off her. So I'll only do it for 20 seconds just to show you what's involved. How do you change this up to make it more presentable to a, and challenging, right? In Waterford, what we would have done over the years, you'd have tackle bags at each of those 6 stations. We'd have 4, we've 6 normally, 6 tackle bags. You'd have a goal on each side, outside the 4 stations. So you'd have a goal here with a goalie on it, a goal here with a goalie on it, a goal here with a goalie, a goal here with a goalie. So after they hit the bag, the group of 3 or 4 of them would meet 2 defenders on the outside of the bag. It'd be a real match situation. They'd have to get a goal. They'd come back to the middle then as well. So you're combining the conditioning part of it, the scoring part of it. And again, you can say, you could do it very simply. Put down 2 cones, and you can say to the boys that are 5 and 6 years of age, if I dribble it through that cone off my weak side, we get an extra point for our team before we come back to the middle. So it's your imagination should be able to dictate how hard or easy you want to make this. You should have the imagination to be able to say, Jesus, you know, there's something in this in terms of working together. Because I'll show you just 2 versions of it now. The first version is just running randomly, couple of passes along the way, give it to the girl, and come back then, okay? Is that all right? Do you know what you're doing? Okay, have a go at it. We'll run it for 30 seconds. Have a go. Off you go, guys. Run now. Run. Anywhere at all. Anywhere. Off you go, guys. Good stuff. Give it to this girl. Get it back here. Good. Off you go. Off you go. Good. Lovely. Working with each other now. Great stuff. In order to introduce the weak strike into that, just this time what we'll encourage is, we'll say to one of the group, I call it, one of the group is kind of drifting away. So, if I'm with this group of 3 here, 3 girls coming with me, yeah? So, what will happen now is, as these, what's your name? Aisling and Kira are going to go towards this girl here, right? So come up with me, Aisling and Kira. This girl, what's your name?
Queeva,
go off there, right? So Aisling and Kira come along here, they give it to this girl, right? They turn around, and Kira's gone 20 yards over there, Kira. Off you go, or Queeva, right? They turn around and they give it to Queeva then, off their weak side. Queeva then goes somewhere randomly. And one of the girls goes up with Queeva, while one other girl gets lazy, I call it. In training, you must have a couple of players that love staying in the pocket for once thrown out to them. You know them? Not lazy, sorry, it's wrong, but you know the people that like it handy, but they're loads of skill. They don't like it handy, is the wrong word, but they're cute. Henry Shefflin got 200 points over the years. People saying, why is he? He's after drifting off into space. So What you can do in order to introduce the weak side strike then is you can say, one of the girls talks to each other and says basically, do you know what? I'm not going to go here. I'm going to go 20 yards. The other girl looks up then and it's a strike off our weak side to her. The other girl catches up then. So it's one girl out of the three or four just deciding, I'm going to drift out. Like a centre forward would do. Noel McGrath is a brilliant example of a fella that just sits out every now and again. It's popped to him because he has the wrists. It's over the bar within a millisecond. You know, he'll have it over, bang, it's gone over the bar. He'll go, and next minute he'll look around him and he'll do this. Look, he'll be looking around him like that. See who's around him, and the next minute he'll be after drifting around, and you think you have him, and all of a sudden he's just gone on you. So it develops that as well as you saying, it develops the weak side and the technicalities of that. It develops the whole idea of you saying to yourself, geez, we're working together here, we're communicating, and it's nothing to do with me. And one of the girls each time says, I'm going to get lazy, I'm going to drift. And again, you just have to call to each other and communicate to each other. So what we'll do here is come back here. We're just going to show you again how that works. So again, if I'm part of this group of four, just imagine I'm part of this group of four. Three of us go this way. Quiva goes away that way, right? The three of us go to here. Hand pass, get it back off one of the girls. Now you're looking around for Quiva, calls for it, and then two ye up ye go with Quiva then, right? And I'd be the one that's getting lazy the next time. You go to somewhere else, then all of a sudden, and what it builds is, it's like a championship match in that when you look up, you say to yourself, Jesus, there's bodies everywhere. There's bodies everywhere, which is the exact same as what Waterford and Tipperary will be like in Welsh Park, or Waterford and Dublin will be like in Welsh Park today at 4 o'clock in the Camogie. You look around, Jesus, there's people everywhere. And it builds the whole idea of everyone being able to see a pass. Now, what you could do then is, you could have the post ready on either side. And according as that girl gets the ball, she throws it over the bar. She throws it over the bar, and then there's just a big bundle of balls here. You come back and get the next group ball for the group of four. And that builds a kind of an even better session. Again, how do you do that with the young lads? You're saying to yourself, oh geez, I've girls starting between 8 and 10. How do I do that? So again, it's ball in hand. It's running around with ball in hand, handing it over to each other. It's a simple thing like rolling the ball to each other. You might have to cone it for the girl or the boy that's getting lazy. You might have to say, you go to the green cone. The other three go somewhere else. So the other three go somewhere else. The other one guys have to go into the green cone and they'd roll it over or they'd hit it over on the ground to the guy that's on the green cone. He'd pick it up. Two of his mates come with him then. They'd run over there. The other lad comes to the green cone. So it gets him used to the whole idea of looking for space at six, but he's not thinking that. He's not quoting things like spatial awareness as a six-year-old, you know what I mean? He's doing it almost in an innate way that's not dominating his thought process. But you've been clever enough to teach it to him without him thinking, I'm all over the place here, where do I need to go? Like, you know? He won't be robotic, it'll come to him. And the repetition of that drill every night, I couldn't emphasize how many times that we tried to do that with Waterford over the years, because it's a very good conditioning drill as well for a 14 to 18 year old group. If you put 45 seconds on the clock, and you ask them to go as hard as they can from group to group, I can tell you now, they'll suffer. Like, they're hitting that bag, they're coming outside the group, they're going through a couple of tackles over the bar, they're back at pace. Two of the girls go in the direction of the girl, one girl go away from the girl, okay? And then just put your hand up to look for the ball afterwards. So you need to talk to each other, are you okay? All right? Off you go, good stuff. Now you're going to go away, good stuff. Look at a lovely example here, perfect. Perfect, and off you go, one girl go with her, one girl, look Quiva, you're going to go lazy, Quiva, good stuff, brilliant, one girl go lazy, brilliant, brilliant stuff, now it's Quiva, look at Quiva, okay. I would normally start off the session with a good old fashioned tussling session, where Elaine is down over the ball and the two of us are tussling over, before I make any, I don't even like using the word technical adjustments or whatever. You know, before I say it to myself, geez, she needs to change that, or she needs to change that, or she needs to be lower in position, or she's not wrapping her up, or she's not getting the hand in. I would normally just leave it flow in terms of a straightforward tussling session. So she'd have the ball, she'd be picking it, I'd be trying to take it off her, blah, blah, blah. Now, then, and I was talking about this with the other group, then you have the situation where, if I'm behind the lane here, and who's very good at this is Noel Connors of Waterford, we say, right? So, how do I develop the ability to be able to lean without pushing in the back? Okay, which is an essential part of the tackle, I think. Say if you're a back, and I know we're trying to encourage people to get out in front, but say you get caught behind, right? that you sometimes, say if you're picking this right, Lane, right? Sometimes when they hear the hurley, trying to give the free these days, right? That was a foul anyway. But even when there's a genuine pick, just pick up again, just slowly now, Lane. And when they hear that, they're inclined to give the free. They're actually inclined to give the free now. I would suggest that one way that I watch Noel doing it is just from a technical point of view, right? Is that after you lean, you make yourself big again. So this sounds very, very robotic now. So after you lean, that you make yourself big. So look, lean, big, because that will stop you pushing in the back. Because if you continue to lean, you're gonna, any cute forward is gonna bring you down over her, and she's gonna win the free. Or she gets a nudge, she's gonna be gone down over the ball as well. So at every level, at 6 years of age, you're saying to yourself, what are you trying to get into them? You're trying to probably get a bit of toughness into them, that they don't mind being over the ball and are not worried about, and you're encouraging the whole idea of getting in close, and that's right. So what I would say is, what Noel is very good is, if he's close enough, he has to hand off the back, he leans back and just pick their, and he's leaning like that. He's almost leaning, but he's not. We don't hear that. We don't hear that, nor do we see this as she's leaning. Look, push on the back. Because he's done that, and he's also nearly decided to come aside, and then because his legs are big enough, he's able to get in over it then, and he's over the ball. So there's three things involved, right? Three things involved. There's the technical, there's the lean back, there's the hurley in over, and then there's the ability to be able to step over with your body. So your bum is part of it as well. Your bum, your thighs are part of the whole process of the tackle, of dispossessing. Now, there's another thing to consider then. I'm right half forward playing this way. I'm not going to make that tackle. And the manager is giving out to me for not being full-blooded. But I've read the situation better. I know that I'm better. I'll go 100 miles an hour, but if I decelerate, I might have a chance of flicking it off her as she picks. So it, the decision is important for you as well. So although we'll hear coaches saying, he's not full-blooded, she's not full-blooded, why didn't she go into it? She may have read the situation better. So as Elaine is picking that, I've decided to come 100 miles an hour, and then I've decided, just as she's reading it, just go ahead and pick there. Just as she's picking, I've been able to dispossess. Okay? A very good drill, in my opinion, for that, for dispossessions, and for people, I suppose, like myself, that are fairly slow. If you get someone stopped, I would always consider the fact that you could get past them. So I would have a very good jockeying drill where myself and Elaine are just following each other's feet there, right? So you just follow my feet, Elaine, right? You just come this way, right? So whatever. And when I blow the first whistle, we both stop. When I blow the second whistle, I go at her. And the two whistles have to come very close together. My consideration here is that no matter how slow you are, you should be able to get past her if you get her stopped. So the whistles have to come like this if you're the coach. Again, you're the six-year-old coach. You're both opposite each other, having the fun, having the crack. The first whistle stop. Then if you want to introduce a bit of fun, you say, left hand up, he has to put left hand up. Right hand up, she has to put right hand up. Two hands up, two hands down. Now go past her. If you want more enjoyable than serious, depending on the level you're at. But if we blow the two whistles, if you just stop, when I blow the whistle and the second whistle, I'll go past you, right? I'll try anyway, right? Right, so if I get her stopped, now I took the advantage of going before I blew the second whistle, because I didn't want to be showing up here like in front of everyone. I know how to crack, like, you know what I mean? So the other thing I'd also consider there in terms of the tackle, just put it in your hand there, right? In terms of the tackle, is the ability to be able to strip the ball from her hand with your hand. Okay? Because sometimes if they're hearing this, if she's in front of you like this, and you're on her, if she's in front of you, sometimes you wouldn't think it just like that. Okay, pouncing on her hand with your hand, as opposed to just pouncing on her in terms of with the hurley, right? So she's in front of you, and you've just been here like this, and you have her held up. The amount of times you can do that, without, you'd be surprised how effective it is. They're not inclined to give the free. Likewise, now I'm not encouraging cynicism. Likewise, the first drill we did over here, where I said to you, don't put your hand to it straight away. A great way to practice that drill in terms of the tackle is if you just allow one player to pick and you catch, just allow the girl to do five picks, but you're not allowed to catch it, I have to catch it. It's a great way of practicing that. So you leave me catch it three times, right? Don't bully me, right? You need to scoop it up to me now, Oscar. If you can, you're spoon feeding me there. Okay, right, so look, I'm gonna catch it three times. Now, Then it can develop into, you go and pick it normally now, it can develop into a war then. Again, you've advanced your team under 14, you have this unbelievable team, you're heading for the fail. You're heading for four in a row and a fail. If you're right-handed, don't be afraid to tackle with the right hand. Okay, so if you go pick that again. So again, I'm in here, and that's not being cynical now. I'm talking about playing the ball legally, with your spare hand. So just to recap, what we'd normally do is, say that you're in the twos, you're tussling. You have the jockeying for the tackle. You have the hand in tackle. You have the right hand tackling. You have the timing to run tackling. Then you're back to your old fashioned. There's a girl here with three or four balls. There's two or three opposite you, you hit the ball in between them, the girls come out, they're tackling, one is trying to get it off the other, they're trying to get around each other over the bar, you're down to that. If you're with the younger group, you just throw the ball in between the two or three of them, you see who's going to get it in their hand and bring it back to you. Who's going to pick it up and actually bring it back to them in your hand? And you'll develop that kind of team mentality as well. Also, what we'd often do then is, and a bigger version of this, so what you might do here is, Ella is here, if you wanted to have a bit of attrition, okay? And Megan is here. Ellen will give the ball here to Megan, to
Lauren.
Right? Lauren would take it, she would take on this girl, and the other girl would get out the outside. And you just have a channel then for tackling. Then you could bring him back to a straightforward square that I have set up over there, and you're concentrating on weak striking. One guy in, one girl in the middle, going to each corner. Then you, all of a sudden, you come back to the attrition here. Then you bring the attrition to the game. And if you think back to the thing that we did where the groups of four are running around, every now and again, I would walk for it. You blow a double whistle. The three girls that half in the ball surround the girl with one ball. They're calling out things like steps, they're calling out things over carrying, they're surrounding her, they're pinning her down, they're making sure that Gilhan, right? They're making sure that they've used their bicep to wrap and come back. So in terms of like almost like the rugby tackle, Stringer was a brilliant man in rugby sense, to be able to wrap a fella and then come back. So that you're not rapping a fella, being down on a fella, and you've told the referee that in advance that we've done a lot of concentration on group tackling, on tackling as a group, on helping each other around the field. And you've been clever enough to say that to the referee, not in advance of the match, but you know, you'll be able to kind of manipulate the situation for yourself though, that'll help you as the match develops, if you like. So I would normally go from the attrition of the tackling drills to just a bit of touch work off either side. If you go back to the original drill, when the groups of four, you can introduce tackle into that as well. So, just by way of a recap, if you say to yourself, A is the pre-activation, all the skills of the game, from striking, to pickups, to the different types of pickups, to hand passing, to dummy hand passing, to third catch, to weaving around, what's it to do with the game? It's everything to do with the game, and it's fun at the start of a thing. Adapt that to your own circumstances. You come into the group drill, I call it. What does it do? It builds a group mentality where everyone is working together. So you have the wing forward hitting the ball, not saying, ah, geez, nothing to do with me now. So they're working together, whatever age group. It also builds the mentality of one person can be cute, stay outside, and they're looking for an easy pass, and they'll get the score, but the other person is responsible for the score. It also can be introduced into the tackle. If you want to advance that drill, put tackle bags in it, put goals on the outside, award points for you know, nobody dropping the ball, all that kind of stuff. Go straight into a game. Go straight into an eight-a-side game here. Have no rules. Just put two sets of posts up before you introduce a rule based on the weak striking or tackling. Then after, call them in after 6 minutes. Say, look, lads, if we get anyone blowing for over-carrying, we're going to give a goal to that team. So next minute, two or three will operate, they'll hunt someone down, they'll get them blown for over-carrying, they get an extra 3 points on their team. Back to the normal flow of hurling then as well. Back to the normal flow. And I would always finish the session with the skills that we've started with, which is originally back to a ball each, soul running, few scores at the end of it to make them feel that it's been an enjoyable session as well. So I'd hate to think that you left here thinking about the dark arts of tackling with one hand or the free hand and all that kind of stuff. It's marrying all those things with the group that you have in front of you. Whatever group you have in front of you. As I said, I have the 5 to 10-year-olds in De La Salle, and we're doing that group one, but we're doing nothing like the girls are doing there with someone going off into space. We're doing it, but the guy boys are rolling into each other, kicking into each other. Sometimes they have no hurlies in their hands doing it to each other. You know, they're running around with the ball in their hand, having fun, but they're building the skills at the same time. So that's basically it. The tackle, the group mentality of working together, and the ability to communicate, I suppose, throughout the session. and bringing it to whatever level they're capable of doing it, which they're very capable here. Is that okay, lads? Okay. Yeah, thanks a million. Thank you. Thank you a million.